Okay, a quiz debrief, grade 11, essential, week 2. It's November 2021. All right, so you were given your quiz. It's just a quiz. It's not a test. It's not an exam. It's worth like about 2.5 assignments. It's just a quiz. I want to see where we're at. I want to see if I'm doing the good thing, if you're doing a little bit of work. All right, so I gave you the formulas. You have the formulas. Plus, you have your own cheat sheet. Plus, you could have used my cheat sheet as well. Oh, I just noticed I did not put the rule of 72 on my cheat sheet. Maybe I'll fix up my cheat sheet. But I understand my cheat sheet. You are going to want to do your own study notes or cheat sheet. All right, so start up on a cheat sheet. Start composing all your... That's all we learned, right, so far. We just learned that little bit of stuff on a piece of paper. All right, so here was the first quiz. First question, rather. Are you ready? Here we go. So you're allowed to use your one-page cheat sheet that you're going to start slowly compiling. Use mine for now, but using somebody else's cheat sheet is not going to help you. And you're always, always allowed a calculator in essential math. If you're doing pre-cal, there's no calculators allowed. All right. But anyway, let's do some multiple choice. 16% of 2,300. Well, you know what? If you don't write percents as 16 per hundred, that's matey for per hundred. There's 100 cents in a dollar. All right. So there's the way to do it. All right, so type that into your plastic brain, but I would suggest you write it down first. All right, if you always write down the numbers you're going to type into your calculator, then that will reduce the chance that you'll mess up. If all you do is grab a calculator and start smashing numbers in, you might forget to divide by 100, or you might do the wrong thing. So always write down the numbers that you're going to crunch into your calculator. Now, some of these were obviously wrong, right? One neat thing about multiple choice is usually there's one or two dumb answers, all right? So how can it be 36,800? You know that 16% means it's a fraction or a portion of 2,300. So it's got to be less than 2,300. That's not less than 2,300. So that's obviously not the correct answer. All right. So right away you would cross that one out. Anyway, when you do it, you come up with that. Okay. Now, you've got calculators, right? You got all kinds of calculators. There's calculators out there. I've showed you multiple times where to find calculators, right? You could just actually, have you ever tried Google? Sometimes for very simple expressions, you can just type it into Google and it'll tell you the answer. Or you can download this one. This is the Google app. If you download it, or if you just do it in your, I'm sorry, not the Google app. This is the Desmos app if you download it. So Desmos Scientific, you can get it online or you can download it. There's a GeoGebra. I've given you a whole bunch of different links to different calculators you might want to download. You might want to download a couple of them. But you know what? Having a handheld $14 calculator is just a little nicer than working on a little itty-bitty tiny screen on your phone. All right, so if you can track down a handheld calculator, that's the way to go. All right, let's do the next one here. Here we go. All right, simplify. So now technically this is not grade 10. All right, but gee, do you know how to do fractions? If you don't, there's probably a button on your calculator that does it. But you know what? I'm trying to get you to just think on your lonesome. Let's do some pizzas. All right. I always try to do stuff without a calculator. I always try to figure out how could I do that on paper. So 1/2 plus 3/4. Are you ready? I know that most of you probably don't do fractions, but I don't know why. It's just pizzas. All right. So let's do some thinking here. Here's half a pizza. Any arguments there? Anybody want to deny that that's half of a pizza? So the shaded in part is the half of a pizza, and that clear part is the part that was missing. Somebody ate that. Now we're going to draw 3/8 of a pizza. So 3 slices of an 8-slice pizza. Can you see we have 3 slices of an 8-slice pizza? Here we have one half or one piece. Here we have one piece of a two-piece pizza. Here we have three pieces of an eight-piece pizza. I think most people break their pizzas into eight slices. Each slice would be an eighth. Now let's add the pieces together. And you're going, well, how do I add little tiny pieces to big pieces? They're not the same size. You can't add apples to oranges. So guess what? You turn the half pizza into eighths. So you pretend it was cut into eight slices. Would you believe that four slices of an eight-slice pizza, look at that, one, two, three, four slices of an eight-slice pizza is half of a pizza. Isn't that amazing? Now you add on the three slices of the eight-slice pizza, and you have seven slices of an eight-slice pizza? Yeah. Have you ever had pizza before? Do you know how pizza works? That's how pizza works. If you know how pizza works, then you know how fractions work. I'm just trying to convince you that fractions aren't that tough. I will slowly sneak these types of simple fractions on you. And if you don't want to do that type of thing, guess what? There's a button on your calculator. But if you're going to be a cook or a carpenter or a plumber or a tradesperson of any type or a nurse or if you want to do any engineering or any science of any type, you've got to know how to do fractions. You might have to go take a separate course on it. I'm just trying to show you that fractions are not that tough. I'm not giving you a lesson in fractions. That would take 30 hours. I don't have 30 hours to teach you fractions. But I think I'm slowly introducing you to the fact that fractions are pretty easy. Next slide. Here we go. All right, let's get into the stuff we're supposed to be doing here. $4,000 is invested at 6% compounded monthly for 15 years. All right, so you're going to take $4,000, you're going to stick it in the bank, you're going to make it a single-shot investment, and you're just going to let it ride. And it's going to keep growing and growing and growing. It's even going to grow on itself because it's compounding. So you write down the formula. Just write down the formula with the letters in it. Don't go putting numbers in yet. All right, now you can plug in the numbers. Right? If you're going to take shortcuts and not do it the way that I model it, I can guarantee you, you're going to mess it up. All right, 6% is 6 divided by 100. So there's 6% if you turn it into one of your decimals. Now we're doing something monthly. So if you do something monthly, that's 12 times a year. Notice that the 12 occurs in two different places. So the 12 goes there and there. And then we got to put the number of years here. And I like to put, if you're going to put it in the calculator, you got to tell the calculator, oh, by the way, that's all the exponent. So you don't have to write it that way. I would suggest you do. But when you put it into your calculator, you better put that in brackets in your calculator. All right, here we go. So there I put it in a couple calculators. I put it in a Desmos calculator. I put it in a Texas Instruments calculator. You could put it in your handheld one that you got at Walmart. You better end up with $9,816.37, no matter which calculator you put it in. All right? So there you go. That ends up being that. 9,816. Now some of you are going, well, what happened to the 37 cents? Ah, did you read the instructions? The instructions said pick the best or closest answer. Sometimes when people talk about money, they don't include the pennies. They'll just go to the nearest dollar. Or sometimes they'll just go to the nearest $100. All right, so just because the answer is $9,816.37. Usually when you're talking about thousands and thousands of dollars, you don't normally worry about the pennies. You can't be bothered to even write them down. All right. Well, another thing you could have done there was, you know what? Often, I'm just trying to show you some of the tricks, some of the strategies, rather, of multiple choice, right? Because these are multiple choice, right? It turns out that you didn't even know how to do any of this stuff, and you could have probably gotten the right answer, all right? So it turns out that often teachers give you one answer that's too high, Okay, so sometimes they give you an answer that's too high and too low. So you want to know a trick? Yeah, a strategy, rather. Yeah, it's usually not the highest number, and sometimes it's not the lowest number. So if you had to just randomly pick one, don't pick the highest one, don't pick the lowest one, right? Now, that doesn't always work, but, you know, it'd be a good strategy. So it turns out when you do the calculation, you come up with that. But it turns out that this one sounded just way too high. And this one, how could it be less? If you put $4,000 in the bank, how could you end up earning $3,600, all right? So how could your $4,000 turn into a total amount of $3,600? Because it says here you earned interest, all right? So it can't be less. And by the way, it can't be this. Even just the rule of 72 tells me it can't be that. You know, what am I saying? The rule of 72. Remember that rule of thumb? Right? 6 times 12. So something compounded at 6%, whether it's monthly or quarterly, doesn't matter. Something compounded at 6% should double after 12 years. So we know that after 12 years, this 4,000 should have been at least probably 8,000. And then it goes a few more years after that. So it's got to be quite a bit more than 8,000 because of the rule of 72. So how could it be 7,600? All right. So using a little bit of the tools that you've got and a little bit of strategy, you'd probably deduce that there's the answer, and you didn't even have to actually do any of these calculations. Once you get rid of the answers that are kind of rogue, the one left over probably is the answer. Do you see how you probably didn't even need to calculate that if you were strategic? I'm just trying to learn you some strategies. All right, two numbers that sum. Now, the word sum means add. If you find a sum, you're adding things together. And the word product means multiply. Go forth and multiply. All right, so let's guess and check. So let's just guess. Is it 10 and 5? Well, 10 plus 5 is 15, and 10 times 5 is 50. And I'm going, well, hold on. Why am I starting my own numbers? They give me 4 different choices. Why don't I just test the 4 choices? Why am I going to start making up my own numbers? That would be silly. It's got to be one of these choices. I'll just test each of these choices. All right, so let's just test those choices. This is called back solving. All right, in multiple choice, it's pretty easy to take each of the 4 answers and test them to see which one works. You don't have to go figuring out the answer yourself. Just test the ones you're given. So let's check. 5 plus 3, we'll do the first one. 5 plus 3 is 8. All right. Well, so obviously that's not going to work because it's supposed to work out to 15. All right, let's try 11 and 4. All right, 11 and 4, that is 15. Woohoo! But hold on, we got to see if it's product when we multiply it. Is it going to be 54? No, it's going to be 44. Bzz, wrong answer. So it's not 11 and 4. Let's try 27 and 2 now. Let's try 27 and 2. 27 plus 2 is 29. Bzz, wrong answer. We're supposed to make it work out to be a sum of 15. 29 is not a 15. So bzz, 27 and 2 didn't work. Gee, I wonder which one is correct. Right, we've already said that one didn't work, that one didn't work, and that one didn't work. Can you kind of see the strategy? It turns out that the last one, right, 9 plus 6 is 15, 9 times 6 is 54. It turns out that's the solution. Right, so this is like a Unit A problem-solving thing. Using some thinking, some strategies, how to attack a problem. Curious, eh? Okay, so while I apologize for this one was probably a little more intense than I intended. I probably won't count this question. I'll probably make this a bonus question. All right, so I still sometimes think in calculus and applied manners instead of the essential stuff. So anyway, let's try it, though. I'm trying to show you also some strategies. It turns out you didn't even need to know any formulas or anything. You could have just probably guessed and gotten the answer on this if you used a strategy. So this would have been tough unless you were a strategic thinker who knew how to do multiple choice questions and get like a really good mark even if you don't understand what you're doing. All right, so let's get rid of what it cannot be. All right, it can't be $6,554. And it can't be $3,516. All right, because that number and that number are bigger than your final total amount. So how can you put in more money and get out less out of your investment? Well, you can if it loses 10%, but this earned 10%. So it is possible to lose money on an investment. Oh, yeah. All right. But this one was earning 10%. All right. So you can't put in that amount of money and get out less money. So right away, those are wrong. So now you only got like two choices. And how can the principal be more than the final amount? That's what I'm saying, all right? So how can those be more than the final amount? It wouldn't make sense. In any event, that leaves you with just two that you got to test, all right? So all you had to really do was test this one and this one to see which one of those two remaining choices would give you the answer. Well, you know what? I got goofy since it was pretty easy to do on a calculator. I just typed them into a Desmos app here, and I did them, boom, 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 and the only one that worked was 2,000, all right? So this is called like guessing and checking, except there's no guessing involved. You're just taking each of the four answers and checking them. This is why multiple choice you should get really good marks on, because usually there's two dumb answers, and then there's usually two answers left over, and then you can just test and see which one works. Can you kind of see how I'm trying to learn you how to do some strategic thinking? Right? Thinking is a mathematical thing. All right, so I'm trying to remind you of some strategies to pass a multiple choice. Eliminate the obviously wrong answers. Usually one choice is a little bit too high, another choice is way too low. Usually the teacher has it so that there's only two practicable answers. And then all you do is you test each answer. You see which one worked. It's called back solving. All right, let's do another one here. All right, so let's, here's how you could have solved it. All right, this is why I'll make this a bonus question instead of one worth marks. But we did actually do this. We did this in class. All right, so you could have actually solved it. So, of course, you know how to do this stuff. You write down the formula. Write the formula. Then you plug in the numbers. Don't go plugging in numbers until you've written down the formula to know what the numbers are going to be. All right, so now you plug in the numbers. The amount that you cashed in was $3,277.23. How much did you put in so that it earned all this interest so that it worked out to be $3,277? So you write down the formula, you plug in the numbers, and then you go, oh, darn, look at that. There's the P. If I can get the P by itself, well, believe it or not, all of this noise here is really just a number. Yeah, you take this on a calculator, turn that into a number. Watch, I'm going to do it down here. You ready? And remember how I said, especially when you're working with money and you want to be accurate, you don't want to be rounding off things. Normally you only round off at the very, very end of a question, right? You don't go rounding off in the middle, because if you round off too much, you'll be using a rounded number times a rounded number plus a rounded number, and before you know it, all you got is a bunch of really close numbers being multiplied together, which isn't going to be all that close. All right, so anyway, this is just the... We did this in class. So to get rid of that 1.638 dot, 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 I divide by the 1.6. Make sure you do it on both sides. If you do the same thing to both sides of a balance, to the both sides of an equals, they're still equal. All right, so now we know what the P is. The P is that divided by that. And when you do it, it comes up to $2,000. Woohoo! And don't forget to check. All right? So once you come up with your solution, after you've juggled numbers around to isolate what you think the answer is for the unknown amount, take your unknown amount, plug it back into the original equation, and see if when you plug 2,000 into here, it gives you the answer that you started with. You wanted to get this. Look, it does give you that. So it worked. So yeah, that would have taken you, that would have taken you like 4 minutes maybe. All right, but again, there was some strategies involved, right? It obviously wasn't that, because how could you put more money in and get less money out? How could you put more money in and get less money out? All you had to do was test each choice. So if you tested each choice, you would have found what the answer was, just like we did here. We tested each choice. All right, so I'll make that a bonus question. I won't make that a... All right, let's do the open response. Here we go. Show your work. I give marks for just even writing down the formula and plugging in most of the correct numbers. I might give you one mark. It's not all about the answer, you know. It's about the thinking. All right, so the I equals PRT. I said it was simple interest. All right, so I is money, P is money, the R is a percentage per year, and the T is years. Right, notice it's bananas and bananas, per year and years. Don't go mixing the units. Write down the units would make sure, if you write down the units, that'll make sure that you don't go mixing apples with bananas. Make sure you understand what each of these symbols means in a formula. Now you've written down the formula. Now you plug in the numbers. And that will tell you what the I is. And I got a plastic ring that says it's $145.83. Show the units. If you don't show the units in a provincial exam, they actually take off a mark. Because they would say, so is that 145.83 pesos or yen or euros? No, you got to tell them that it's dollars. There is other forms of money. And then, of course, the total amount that you pay back your aunt, right? Your aunt wants her $3,500 bucks back, plus she wants her $145.83. So your aunt is going to want $3,645.83. Thanks, Auntie. All right, how about Nicole here? Nicole was lucky. The day she was born, her uncle bought her a $3,500 Canada savings bond. They don't exist anymore. I think we got rid of them about in 2018. But you write down the formula. It's still a compounding interest thing. Write down the general formula. Now you plug in the numbers. Here come the numbers. 8% is 0.08. It's 8 divided by 100. The S is 12. If you do something monthly, you do it 12 times a year. Now you smash those numbers into a calculator. But make sure you've written down what numbers you're going to smash in first. Don't just go smashing numbers into a calculator unless you've written all of this down first. All right, so there's the answer. Her uncle bought her $3,500 worth of a savings device, and after 18 years, it turns into $14,702. So she can go to the bank and cash it in. Woohoo, nice. Now, the rule of 72, remember that one? The rule of 72 says if you take the interest rate and multiply it by the time in years, if that equals 72, then you doubled your money. All right, so we've got the 8 times the time has to equal 72. So 8 times T is 72, so that means T equals 9. So if you want to know how long it will take to double your money, it will take 9 years. There you go. So the answer is it takes 9 years to double your money. That answers the second part. But guess what? Isn't 18 years just a 9 and a 9? So really, didn't Nicole's money double twice? Right, can you kind of see how some of these tools are useful? So 9 years to double to 7,000. So in 9 years, her 3,500 doubled to 7,000. And then in another 9 years, it doubled again. So it would double to, in nine more years, double again to 14. Can you kind of see how you could have got a pretty rough answer to this? You could have just said, well, 18 years is two doublings. You could have just said, oh, the 3,500 is going to double and then double again. It's a double-double. So you could have just in your head said, oh, it's about $14,000. All right, so it's 14,702. But pretty close if you want to just do it in your head. All right, so that's the advantage of the rule of 72. Oh, I know this is pretty intense, especially if you didn't do the grade 10 with us. All right, let's complete this simple interest table. We did lots of this, and you had a workbook full of these things. So I wrote down the formula, I plugged in the numbers. There we go. Answer is 300. Boom. All right, so 5 years, 6%, $1,000 that you invested, you earn $3,000. So you're going to have $1,000 plus the $300 you earn. That answer there is going to be $1,300. $1,300. Here it comes. Because the amount that your investment's worth is what you put in plus the interest. So it's going to be $1,300. All right, let's do question two. Now, this one's going to take a bit of juggling, right? This is going to involve juggling or algebra, right? So you write down the formula, you plug in the numbers. Oh, now see, we don't know what the I is. We don't know what the I is, and we don't know what the T is. But we have this other formula, remember? We have this other formula that says that the A is the principal plus the interest. So we know the amount that it's worth. So the interest must have been, oh, that, take away that, is 400, right? So we know the interest was 400. So we know that if you put in 2,000 and you got out 2,400, you must have earned 400. Now we can use that to figure out the time. All right, so you got 400 is equal to 2,000 times 5/100 times T. Guess what we're going to do? We're going to tidy this up. We're going to turn that into one number. Isn't that going to be 100? Sure it is. How do I get rid of that 100? That 100 is messing up my T. I'm going to divide both sides by 100. Boom. If you do the same thing to both sides, you didn't change the equilibrium. So the answer is 4. And don't forget to check your answer. Take the 4 years that you think is the answer, plug it into the original equation, right? Boom, 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 and see if it gives you 400. If when you take your answer and you plug it in right there and it gives you the 400 that you started with, then you know you did it right. Students always forget to do that. I don't know why. You don't need an answer key when you do this stuff. You just check your answer to see if it worked. All right, anyway, so the last one there, question three, I equals P times R times T. Oh, notice I did a mistake there too. All right, did you see how I had to cross it out and fix it up? This is why being nice and neat and methodical and doing the same thing every time is very useful, because the numbers aren't always this easy. All right, so be neat, methodical, organized, do the same steps every time, and then it's easy to see when you make a boo-boo. If you just have numbers flung all over the place, or you don't even bother writing any numbers down, right? If all you do is crunch numbers into the calculator, well, then you're not going to notice your boo-boos. So I get $12.67. $12.67 added to the 500. $512.67. Next slide. Here's Carla. She goes to a payday loan. She borrows $600. All right, so I told you during the test there that use simple interest. Well, you could use compound, but you know what? Compound and simple interest, as we saw in our notes and as we discussed, they're pretty much the same thing for a short time. All right, so if it's a short time, if you were to graph it, do you know how to graph stuff? It turns out that if this was simple and this was compound, you know, they kind of, they're not a huge difference if you got a very short number of years. So often you can solve many problems just by pretending it's simple, as long as it's not for lots and lots of years. All right, so let's tidy up this, right? So you wrote down the formula, you plugged in the numbers. Let's tidy up all these numbers, turn them into one number, right? I hope you can do that on a calculator or in your head, right? 600 times 2 is 1,200 divided by 12 is 100. So 100 times your mystery number is $40. All right, so divide by $100, divide by $100. Look at that. Did the same thing to both sides. If you do the same thing to both sides, it still is equilibrium. You end up with 0.4, which is 40%. So the rate of interest is 40%. They're actually legally allowed to charge 60%, by the way. Let's check our answer. All right, let's take that 40% and see if it works. Just as a little, it takes like, what, 15 seconds to do this? All right, 600 times 40 per 100 type, does it give you the 40? Yeah, look, so we plugged in the 40% into here, we multiplied it by the 600, we multiplied it by the 2, we divide it by 12, and it did tell us that it was 40. So you know that you did it right. You got 100% on that one too, and you know it because you checked it. People still don't check their answer. I guess 20 seconds is important. All right, bonus marks. All right, so here we got some bonus marks. I always ask bonus questions. Now, these are thinking questions. Now, unfortunately, we did lots of these in grade 10. So if you're just straight into grade 11 and you bypass the grade 10, yeah, you might have a slight disadvantage at first, but you'll accelerate into it. So the method I was suggesting before was guess and check. So we're just going to guess how much a hot dog is. So three hot dogs and one Coke cost $12. One Coke is $2 less than a hot dog. How much does a hot dog cost? There, it's a pretty straightforward question, right? All right, this, you might encounter this if you took your kids to a hockey game and somebody says, how much is a hot dog? I want to get one too, right? So you're going to guess. Guess and check will always work. All right, so you're going to guess that one hot dog is $2. That means three hot dogs must be $6 because 2 times 3 is 6. And we said that a Coke is, well, we said that a Coke is $2 less than a hot dog, right? So if there's your hot dog, all right, then a Coke would be $2 less. Okay, so 6 plus 4 is 10. Bzz, wrong answer. All right, so, oh, hold on. I notice I made a mistake here. Stand by. I'm going to fix it up. Stand by. I'm going to fix it up. I'll fix it up later. I notice I made a mistake right here. So see the advantage of being organized? I noticed I made a mistake as I was doing this because you would always go back and check your stuff, right? So if one hot dog was $2, then three hot dogs would be $6. And then a Coke would be, well, according to this, a Coke is $2 less than one hot dog, not three hot dogs. So a Coke would be $2 less than $2, which would mean the Coke was free. So you're getting three hot dogs for $6 and a free Coke. Well, that wouldn't come to $12, would it? It would have been $6. So bzz, that was wrong. All right, so there, I fixed up my mistake. I made that mistake on purpose, by the way. All right, so let's try $3. Let's think. I wonder if $3 is the answer. $3? If I spent $3 for one hot dog, that means the three hot dogs that I bought would have been $9. And it says here that a Coke is $2 less than the one hot dog. So one hot dog is three. Three minus two is one. So that means I would have spent $9 for the three hot dogs and $1 for the Coke would be $10. Bzz, wrong answer. It should have been 12. So you're going, oh, you know what? I'm probably getting closer, right? So you guess it, 350. All right, so we'll guess it 350 because we know we're getting close. And guess what? Three hot dogs at 350 apiece is 1050 plus that $1.50 Coke. And how did I know the Coke was $1.50? Because it says here that a Coke is $2 less than a hot dog. Here's a hot dog, $3.50. Take away two is $1.50. So $10.50 for the three hot dogs, $1.50 for the Coke. Does that add up to $12? Oh, please. Oh, please. Yeah, it does. Woohoo. It does work out. Now you know you got the right answer. So the question was, how much is a hot dog? Well, a hot dog is $3.50. Now, I notice that a lot of people just managed to guess in their head, but I want to see you write down how you get your answer. When I say show your work, I want to see you show your work. So actually take the time to write down the answer and even show that it checks. Don't just write down the answer because I don't know what you're thinking. Maybe you Googled it or something, right? Which you shouldn't be doing because you're only supposed to be using your calculator. All right, so anyway, there's a bonus question. Next slide. Now, wait for it. Now, I got to show you this. I'm sorry, but I do have to show you this. This movie's going to be a big one because, you know, this is your very first quiz, but I've got to show you how you're going to do it if you do any advanced math, like applied or pre-cal. Here we go. So if you don't like this, if you don't plan on being a nurse and you don't plan on doing any science and you don't plan on being a teacher, then you can skip this. All right, so move ahead, skip this. All right, but here's how you would do it if you were doing applied math or pre-calculus. Skip this if you are going... Skip this if you are not going to do applied. All right, so skip this if you are not going to do applied. All right, so here, let me just advance it like this. All right, so what you're going to do is you're going to say, so I want to say skip this if you are not going to do applied. So what we'd say is we want to find out the price of a hot dog, okay? So skip through this. So we'll let X be the mystery price. And we go, okay, so that means three hot dogs plus a Coke. And you're going, well, how much is a Coke? We don't know, so we give it a letter. Why? So three hot dogs, so three times the price of one hot dog plus the price of one Coke equals $12. But then this sentence here says one Coke is $2 less than a hot dog. So one Coke, remember a Coke is why? One Coke is two less than hot dog. So now you got two separate ideas. Three hot dogs plus a Coke is 12. One Coke is $2 less than a hot dog. Boom, that's what that says. And then you go, well, hold on, why is X minus 2? So you take X minus 2 and you plug it in. So now you got 3X plus X minus 2, because Y is X minus 2, equals 12. And then you say, well, let's take away that 2. Let's add 2 to both sides. All right, let's get rid of that negative 2. So we add 2 to both sides. Boom, so now you got 4X's is 14, divide by 4X is 350. Which means that a Coke is $1.50. All right, so this is how you would do it in applied and pre-calculus. None of this guessing and checking stuff. I wanted to show you that it's a considerably different way of doing stuff. Or the other thing we're going to do in applied math is we're just going to graph things. So we'll graph the situation. We'll make graphs and lines and charts. And you can just do that and that, and then it tells you the answer right there. This is what we will be doing in applied math. Skip all this if you don't plan on ever taking applied math or being a nurse or a teacher or do any science or any advanced accounting. All right, let's do this one now then. All right. So, again, if you weren't with us in grade 10, which is actually a prerequisite for this course, then this might have been a little bit of work. Turns out it's pretty easy if you understand the principle. All right, so it turns out that you could take your calculator and take all of those numbers and add them together. I wanted to know the sum when you add together all the whole counting numbers from 1 to 30. 465. So I put that in my Texas Instruments calculator. I put it in a Desmos calculator. No matter what you do, they all add up to 65. 465. Now, if you're trying to do this on a Dollarama calculator or just the calculator that comes on your phone, yeah, it's not going to work. All right, but wait, you know what? This is what we learned in grade 10. We did this about 10 times in grade 10. Check this out. Math is actually the search for patterns. It's not numbers. All right, so have you ever noticed that if you took the 1 and the 30, that would be 31? And then how about if I went the 2 and the 29? Well, that would be another 31. So instead of adding up all your numbers from left to right, why don't you start on the outside and work your way in? See, if you start on the outside and work your way in, you're going to keep getting a whole bunch of 31s. How many 31s are you going to get? Well, if you're pairing them up two at a time, aren't you going to get 15 31s? What's 15 times 31? There you go. It's 465. Woohoo! All right, so that works for any number of numbers. All right, so it turns out that, yeah, this is called a pattern. It's not a trick. Math is patterns. Math is thinking, looking for patterns and relationships. It's not crunching decimal numbers into a calculator. All right, we did lots of that in grade 10. I made this a bonus just to help out the grade 10 folks there. All right, area of a circle. This was a grade 10 question. I'm just trying to see who remembers the grade 10. So I guess this quiz wasn't really very friendly. So, but if you didn't do grade 10, you are going to have a little bit of extra work to do, maybe. All right, you may have a little bit of extra work to do if you didn't do the grade 10. We did this in grade 10. All right, it turns out the area of a circle is pi times the radius squared. So that's how many squares would be inside that circle if you marked off little tiny squares. So you write down the formula. Oh, my God, I say that all the time. Then you plug in the numbers. Well, the area is that. So we know we got to solve. So we got to get the r by itself. So we got to get rid of that pi. So we got to divide both sides by pi. There we go. Now you know what the radius multiplied by itself is. So now you use that unsquare button. All right, so the unsquare of all of that is going to be 6.18. All right, so you say, woohoo, the radius is 6.18. But I didn't ask for the radius. I asked for the diameter. Do you remember what a radius and a diameter are? Remember how a radius radiates from the middle? And a diameter, dia means to cut. Right, a diameter cuts a circle in half. You want the diameter. So I hope you realize that a radius is only half of a diameter. So you'd have to take that 6.18 and double it, and it's 12.36. All right, so that was a grade 10 question. If you didn't follow any of that, you and I, probably me too, we're going to have a little bit of extra work to do. I don't really want to teach grade 10 over and over again in grade 11. But we'll show you this stuff again very quickly for like 10 minutes. All right, so there you go. So that was the week 2 quiz. Sorry, it was a bit more challenging than I wanted. Some of it was grade 10 stuff, though. Plus, I wanted to let you see, by the way of introduction, how some of the applied math methods we'll be using. So I showed you some of the more advanced methods of solving problems, just so you can see what's going to be happening in applied math if you do the applied math. If some of that was too advanced, well, in essential math, we don't do all the fancy stuff. But you know what? The applied math is actually easier, really, if you're in the right frame of mind. All right, so there we go. Load clear. So that was a pretty long movie. I wanted to make this first one a good one so you could see where we're going. Complete.